Today is Monday, September 27th. We are a bit delayed today. It is not 5 o'clock, it is 5:30. So thank you for your patience. City Council was conducting interviews prior to, so we appreciate you tuning in just a little bit behind schedule. We have a hybrid meeting and we appreciate those of you who are able to tune in online. Reminder that you can access how to attend our meetings, submit public comment, and follow along on our agendas at readingpa.gov. So that being said, we have a really concise agenda for our committee of the whole this evening. First today is the 18th Wonder update, which is 20 minutes. We have 20 minutes scheduled for that today. And we have several representatives. And please, from the 18th Wonder, who would be introducing this and the others? Who is my point person today, since I know all of you? Who's going to start talking first?
Lucy, now I'll be sharing my screen and then Sarah will kick us off.
Okay, Katie, do you have access for screen sharing? Do you want to check that now? And then while we do that, as you know, the 18th Ward is part of District 1, which is my district. It is a very active association of different stakeholders. Really nice representation of public-private partnership and activity. We have a presentation this evening discussing one of the projects that really, I think, was put together through the security and clean areas by John Masano's oversight, I think. And not to forget to mention that we have the chair of the 18th Wonder Improvement Board with us this evening, Mr. Dave Tallarico as well. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to both Katie, who, yes, you have access.
Recording in progress.
To share your screen. And to Sarah, who are fellows and will be graciously presenting us with the information this evening. Ladies, go ahead.
Can everyone see my screen okay? Okay, go ahead, Sarah.
Awesome. Good evening, everyone. My name is Sarah Mattarella, and I'm the Graduate Assistant of Communications at Alvernia's OPAIC Institute for Economic Development and Entrepreneurship, as well as serve as a consultant for multiple projects for the 18th Wonder Improvement Association. I also live, work, and go to school in the 18th Ward.
Hello, everyone. My name is Katie Hester. I'm the Graduate Assistant of Strategy at Alvernia's OPAIC Institute. I also serve as a consultant for the 18th Wonder, and I go to school and go to work in the 18th Ward.
And today we will be presenting on behalf of the 18th Wonder in regards to the beautification of the 18th Ward Street Sweeper Project.
So today we'll be covering the background of the project, of course, the project itself, including the problem and our proposed solution, and then the sustainability of that proposed solution.
With that, the 18th Wonder's vision is to serve as a catalyst in changing the culture surrounding litter and dumping in the rest of the wards in Reading through this street sweeping project. And Alvernia University serves as the anchor organization in the 18th Ward with OPAIC fellows like Katie and myself committed to its improvement, which we'll briefly touch on later on in the presentation.
So when we examine the regional setting of the 18th Ward, we find that there's a land area of 2.3 square miles. And in those 2.3 square miles, there is a whole lot going on. Everything from Brookline Park to Quaker Made to many homes and apartments. So due to this diverse population of attractions, businesses, educational institutions, and residential locations, this is a significant area to keep clean.
This project is being proposed largely due to the study that was conducted in 2020 in regards to the cost of litter and dumping in Pennsylvania. This study yielded that 89% of litter and dumping related expenditures in Reading are allocated for abatement versus more preventative measures, totaling up to $1,841,800 annually out of the $2 million total costs spent on litter and dumping. In addition to these abatement dollars, many projects have been geared toward reducing litter and dumping in the 18th Ward by the 18th Wonder, the City of Reading, the residents of the 18th Ward, and many other groups. And according to the study, despite these previous initiatives, such as city cleanups, municipal and private hauling services, et cetera, as well as the $2 million litter cost, The litter and dumping issue remains in effect throughout the 18th Ward, ultimately devaluing the community's overall investment in solving these issues. And therefore, we want to move toward a more preventative approach through this project.
So as Sarah mentioned, the problem of litter is an ongoing problem where we are spending 89% of our efforts on abatement, which has been proven to be ineffective. So today we present to you a more preventative measure of street sweeping. So to be clear, today we are pitching on a street sweeping pilot program to last for 12 months, but upon a successful pilot program in the future, we hope for a fully funded and operational street sweeping program in the 18th Ward. So the 18th Wonder and the City of Reading have invested significantly into the beautification of the 18th Ward. The Oak Brook Line is a prime example of those investments. And without proper maintenance through best management practices, essentially we're trashing up these investments and devaluing them, lessening ROI. So if we would just use a portion of that $1.8 million that we spent on abatement for more preventative measures, such as street sweeping, ultimately we could lower the total amount spent on the problem of litter at large. And this would yield more net funds to be allocated across other areas of the city that are in need. And of course, it's imperative to the 18th Wonder's mission and vision to always strive for continued improvement in the ward.
While the main goal is for this project to serve as a blueprint for other wards in the Reading community, the pilot program that Katie referenced will focus strictly on the 18th Ward, encompassing Millmont, Oak Brook, and Wild Missing Park, which takes up 32.2 miles for the total sweeping area. And as Katie mentioned as well, this will be a 12-month pilot program with a schedule of 5 days per week, also including off times where applicable, including Saturday, Sunday, and evening times. And finally, the 18th Wonder will also manage oversight for this project, including logistics viability, effectiveness of marketing initiatives, and the litter removal in general. And of course, resident satisfaction. And it's to be noted that for this project, we will not be making people remove their cars off of the street to further generate community buy-in and to make sure that the residents know that this is for them and geared towards them.
So what you're seeing here on the screen is a case study. In 2019, Philadelphia ran a street sweeping pilot program over the course of 12 months in 6 different communities. And after the pilot program, they administered a survey. The results of the survey are on the screen. 96% of residents in each pilot area supported expanding the program across the city. 91% supported moving their vehicles. 78% recommended sweeping weekly. And if we fast forward to 2021, the City of Philadelphia has allocated $62 million over the next 5 years to expand that street sweeping program. So it was wildly successful.
In addition, the Opaque Institute will manage a bilingual marketing and communications campaign involving social media and traditional marketing materials to also generate community buy-in as well as provide information about the project.
And in addition to bilingual communication, we'll also be providing litter education programs. We believe the vehicle to changing attitudes and behaviors surrounding litter is through education of the youth. We will engage with local school districts to incorporate litter education into the curriculum. And this will create a positive cultural value and norm that will trickle from child to parent. This has been used before and has been published in many peer-reviewed journals, as you can see from the example on the screen. This has been used in areas for decreasing smoking and decreasing energy consumption.
Furthermore, this project, as well as other future projects from the 18th Wonder, comply with environmental, social, and governance standards and objectives that measure the impact on the environment, the community, and how the company is managed in general. And nationwide, proactive and future-focused companies use these standards as part of their business strategy and purpose.
So street sweeping brings a plethora of benefits. The environmental benefits include improved water quality, improved storm drain maintenance, protection of fish and wildlife, and a clean, safe, and united community. It's important to note the photos throughout this presentation and our full proposal were taken in the 18th Ward. And the scariest part is actually what we can't see. We can see the litter clogged into the drain, which is obviously a problem, but we can't see microplastics that are about the size of a sesame seed and penetrating through that grade and into our water system. Continuing on, the social benefits include improved safety for pedestrians and cyclists, decreased crime, increased property value, and enhanced traffic safety.
The final integral pillar of ESG is governance compliance. And with that, the 18th Wonder declares that there is no conflict of interest with regard to benefits from the project or any information regarding the project, and that it will continue to make an impact in the Reading community as a trusted community leader. Furthermore, the 18th Wonder will remain transparent and collaborative throughout the progress of this project and also be in accordance with city and community guidelines and acceptance.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today, we respectfully ask the City Council of Reading to invest in a 12-month pilot program of either a diesel street sweeper and its associated cost for $259,500, or an electric hybrid street sweeper and its associated cost for $379,500. This investment is comprised of either a $12,500 a month monthly lease for the diesel street sweeper, or a $22,500 monthly lease for the hybrid electric street sweeper. These numbers, although realistic, are for estimating purposes only. We feel that the City of Reading, with their government purchasing power, could negotiate these leases down. Now, we also realize the city currently uses Timeco 600 street sweepers. There will obviously be operational cost efficiencies if we continue with this similar make and model of equipment. Maintenance is included in these monthly lease. And we made the assumption that fuel, general liability insurance, and dumping fees could be included in the city's present annual budget. Parking the unit at Thomasano Auto Park for efficient logistical purposes would be free of charge. Now, also included in the total budget figures is the cost of the driver operator, who would either be a contract union driver or prevailing wage temporary employee. Again, these assumptions are realistic for costs, but would obviously have to be approved by all the departments that would be affected. We also factored in an increased hourly driver's wage because the streeper would be operating at nights and weekends so that the public won't be burdened with moving their vehicles. Sarah?
Some other supplementary requisites that occur with this project that occur at no cost include the bilingual communication plan that was mentioned earlier, as well as collaboration with the park administrations where street sweeping would occur after games and events that have more traffic and thus more trash. In addition, the collaboration with the local school districts that Katie mentioned for the litter education, and John will expand upon accountability and oversight as well.
Thank you. Now, accountability and oversight are paramount. To that end, I will be personally involved with this project. We will be having weekly meetings at Thomasano Auto Park every Wednesday where everyone is invited in person or via Zoom link. Our discussions will include, but not be limited to, tonnage collected, route efficiency, public feedback, driver feedback, technical skill, cost per mile, and any other measure that the city and streets department would want. My personal cell phone will be emblazoned in 3-foot high digits on the side of the sweeper.
Now, as I mentioned earlier, we are pitching for a pilot program, but of course, upon a successful pilot, we We would like a fully funded and operational program. And we believe the way to do that is through public and private partnership. So we will garner investment from the local, national, and international businesses in the 18th Ward at $5,000 per share, with the goal of an overall investment of $100,000 from the private sector. Now, Tomasano Inc. has committed to 2 shares, totaling our seed money to $10,000 and $90,000 left to reach our goal.
Thank you, Katie. Just to wrap up, certainly we appreciate the council's time and consideration this evening. Before we take questions, I wanted to just close with a few thoughts. Our vision and the vision of the city are in alignment on the 2 key goals of this proposal. First of all, the goal to beautify the city of Reading and provide a high quality of life. Secondly, to make our city clean and safe. The proposal assists in that effort and protects the investments being made in the Oak Brook Line and other areas of the city. Please note that the 18th Ward residents and business leaders are committed to assist in a private and public partnership to create success. With that, I'll open it up for any questions.
Okay, thank you, Don, and to Sarah and Katie and John. And thank you for pulling the presentation down, but please keep it available just in case anybody would like to reference something. I see that Councilman Ventura has her hand up, so we'll open up and begin with Melissa.
Good evening. Thank you for your presentation. So I guess I'm a little confused as to, does the 18th Ward not have like regular street sweeping like the rest of the city, or this is going to be an addition to that?
Should I take that?
Yeah.
We first of all, I want to commend the street department, because about 4 years ago or 5 years ago, we called and said, hey, can you run the street sweeper over here? Every Wednesday, faithfully, they run it in the 18th Ward. What we're proposing is a total saturation to have the street sweeper running 5 days a week, 8 hours a day. I feel that's the only way we're going to really take care of the trash issue. And as we all noted, we're going to be running this on nights, Saturdays and Sundays, so that we get the opposite traffic patterns. And again, so we don't burden the public. We appreciate the efforts of the streets department, but 1 day a week, as we've seen, isn't going to do the job. That's why we're proposing for this a full-time street sweeper and driver.
Thank you. Melissa, any other questions?
No, thanks.
Okay. Marcia, I believe you're next.
Yeah, I wanted to make some comments. First of all, thank you for the excellent and concise presentation. And just my one thought, in being in a lot of different urban areas, the ones that I've seen that have stayed the cleanest have indeed daily street sweeping. And when I see what happens in my neighborhood from one week to the next, it speaks to, first of all, needing a higher volume of street sweeping, and also the component you spoke about as far as public education. I also believe that it is difficult for us that represent other parts of the city to be able to say all the efforts are going to be concentrated on the 18th Ward, but I do believe in doing a pilot program. So my question to you is the data to evaluate the effectiveness within a 1 year pilot. And you may have alluded to that somewhat, but I think that's really key for us to be able to then look at how we can fund and replicate it throughout the city.
I'd like to address that. I think what we've seen in the study that was done just 2 years ago, that by spending all this money on abatement, we're really never going to get ahead of the game. You know, we're taking care of the symptom, we're not taking care of the cause. So by shifting gears to a more effective approach to trash, you know, it's like John, John says all the time, like, go to Disney World, right? They're constantly walking around behind you cleaning up. So Disney World is beautiful. Everybody wants to go there. You know, this is the kind of the theory behind what we would like to do. And again, this is, we want to run this pilot program so that it can expand in other areas of the city. We feel confident that we're going to have good results. When we talk about education, I have firsthand information with the educational aspect. When we alluded to education through like energy awareness, we did that at the Housing Authority. And it turns out, you know, we had a poster contest and that turned into a calendar and all the children were going home and, you know, showing their posters and parents were now suddenly like not running the water and walking away. We feel like we can have the same impact that we had on energy. We've seen that it's proven. And we need to get into the educational system about litter and taking care of our surrounding areas. So I hope that helps.
Thanks, Dave. Okay. Go ahead, Marcia.
Yeah, and I would just be able to like to have a further dialogue with you about evaluation and what that entails, because indeed you're using some proven practices, but it would be very extraordinary if we could become one of those study sites to be able to look at the effectiveness. I think that, and there's a lot of good things. There's a lot of good evaluators, of course, working with the university. You might be able to help support that. So we can have an offline discussion about that in more detail.
Excellent.
Other questions or comments? Council body, and then I also want to open it up to our administrative team that is also on committee of the whole.
Well, Lucine, I have a couple of just quick points. So, you know, the street sweeping program, there's parts of the city, I think about the 600 blocks North Front Street, which I walk on a lot of times. And on a Thursday, the street sweeper goes by and the gutter is loaded with trash. And unfortunately, what we've done is we've led people to believe that it's our job to pick up their trash. And I've always been a big believer, if I ran that department, and I don't, that there would be a prerequisite of compliance of everybody in that neighborhood of keeping their properties clean long before we become your cleaning service. So I've seen it work against us. And that's not in any way trying to take away from the value of street sweeping. But I think we've created a lot of problems as well. Now, there are certain neighborhoods like my block, we sweep our sidewalks frequently and we don't even sweep it into the gutter. We try to pick it up, put it in the trash can. And when the street sweeper does come by, it gets a couple leaves and whatever, a cigarette, but not 60 cans. And you have to literally see it sometime. So one of the things I've always felt is that our street sweeping program really is a cover up for our inability to enforce keeping things clean. And that's nobody's fault. It's just inherently everyone likes street sweeping. It's convenient. More people have asked for it. So we've grown the program over the course of time. The only way I could support a pilot program is if this is brought forward your team through the administration in conjunction with them, because there are so many things that go along with street sweeping, codes enforcement, parking enforcement, a number of things, as well as obviously the union issues, et cetera, capital expenses, including our long-term capital expense plan. So I agree with Marcia. I'd like to hear a little bit more on the program. Excellent presentation, by the way. We know you guys are doing wonderful things over there. I am an 18th ward byproduct. Not that that matters to anybody, but I used to go shopping at Wise when Tasty Cakes were 7 cents. You know, and Wise used to be, by the way, at the footing there of the Oak Brook projects many years ago. I don't know, John, if that's not part of your, but.
When I started working at Oak Brook, Weiss was there 38 years ago.
Yeah. I lived on Sky Street for many years. So it's a great neighborhood. I'm just going to encourage that this be brought to us through the administration, coordinate it, get their buy-in. I don't think the body's opposed to a concept, you know, of a neighborhood trying to improve it, but we got to manage costs. We've got to manage our other resources in the most effective way. And that's our job. And the danger for council, we don't approve kind of administrative functions without the administration, because it's just not something we can do. So those are my comments. I appreciate the opportunity and I appreciate the great work. Thank you.
Thanks, Jeff. So that was Strad, I want to make sure that you've also spoken or commented. Since I'm going to give you that opportunity. Strat, do you have any comments or questions?
Yes, I remember the 18th Ward being one of the most cleanest areas in the city. I can remember that. I'm older than anybody up there on the screens. But my concern right now is the figures that you were throwing on here for costs. Does that include the entire 18th Ward or just Lancaster Avenue?
The entire, it's the entire 18th Ward.
It's in the 18th Ward. We had an engineering study is 32 miles of road. So if you take both sides, that'll be 64 miles. And the street sweeper, that would be running full time in Wyomissing Park, Oak Brook, and Millmont.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Johnny.
Yes. Hi. Thank you for the presentation. I love the work that the 18th Ward or 18th Wonder is doing in our city. However, from the study that was conducted, I think in 2020, in your presentation, where it says that the city of Reading spent about $1.8 million on litter abatement, do we know the exact amount spent in the 18th Ward? Do we have an estimate? That's question one. And question two is, have we reached out to the city? Because maybe it's time then for the administration to also assess the effect of our street sweeping program and how to make it more effective to prevent the litter abatements. But I am curious to know the answer to the first question. We know how much of that litter abatement was from the 18th Ward, if possible.
I don't believe it was broken down that way, but I do have a contact because I was part of that study. They interviewed the Reading Housing Authority for our Center City properties, Glenside and Oak Brook combined. I can look into that. I can ask if they how they broke that down, if they broke it down by ward or not, if they're glad to do that.
Thanks, Dave. And I know we have members of the administration on the call as well. I see Stan. And I think that if it's able to break down some of those metrics that we have by ward, I'm certainly, we can try to help ascertain that information. And I want to also give the opportunity for anybody on behalf of the administration to ask or make any comments.
Yes. In fact, I'd like to kick that off, if I may, before Stan talks about metrics. Thank you for the presentation. Greatly appreciate it. We will take this presentation and this request internally, deliberate on it, just like every other single one. And we'll certainly let you know what we think. We think that some of the questions that have been raised this evening are legitimate, very valid. And we look forward to further discussion on that. So I just wanted to make that clear from our standpoint. Thank you.
Thank you, Abe. And so at this time, I just want to, kind of close it up here. And I know that the individuals representing the 18th Wonder have been working on this for quite some time. Mm-hmm. And so I wonder if you had listened to the mayor's summit and council participating last week. Because I think one thing that you've touched on that was very significant was collaboration. What you have presented today, and you did receive a lot of accolades, but let me give you another one. This was very professionally done. Thank you for representing the university and yourselves in the quality of workmanship that we like to see and really outstanding. So I'm sure that we'll be able to share this as well so others can catch this. That being said, I think that we've talked about collaboration, and what this is demonstrating is the fact that there is the opportunity for entities like the 18th Wonder or any organization or association throughout the city of Reading or beyond to come in and be an appropriate partner with the city of Reading. To Council President's comment earlier, we certainly don't want everybody to feel that it's the city's responsibility to clean up all the trash. I think that what you have presented is actually a genuine response to that, to say, you're right. And here we are, we want to invest as citizens and businesses who live here to assist and work in partnership with the city on some of these issues, which, you know, afflict us every single day. So, you know, I think it's very well thought through. The fact that, you know, if we can come from a financial standpoint of prevention as opposed to abatement, you know, that's part of our fiscal responsibility as council. So there shouldn't be any question there. And in terms of the community accountability and stewardship, I think for me, that's one of the most important pieces here, because this isn't, you know, the citizens versus the government. I think this is of and by the people, you know, to really engage and improve and to have them hold the program and the pilot accountable. So, you know, if it's not working, come tell us, you know, because this is something that we want to move forward. I think it's totally possible that we create this model and that this model then is replicated by ward, mm-hmm. by district. And what it does is really enhance the areas in which the city cannot and should not be 100% responsible, you know, for certain aspects of maintaining your cleanliness. We've talked about quality of life. We've talked about litter. You know, some of this just has to come back to a genuine stewardship of every individual and every neighborhood and, you know, and so on and so forth. So I think this really heightens a lot of what the mayor has identified as, you know, his priorities, and also, you know, the, I think, ability and strength of public-private partnerships and how they can enhance and really increase the impact of what we can do as the city of Reading. So with that, I want to thank all of you for your presentation and your continued efforts and work. We'll look forward to speaking with the administration. I hope you are available because I know some council members would like to continue some one-on-one dialogue and questions. So please make sure to keep in touch with us and we'll move this forward as we can.
Just a question, Lucien, to try to understand the process is how soon would we expect to hear or when it would be looked at by the administration and others to kind of move forward?
So I don't have the schedule in which the administration would consider what's been presented, but my understanding from Council President is that the administration then would need to move this forward for consideration and deliberation to the council. Council mm-hmm. President, do you want to add on to that? You're on mute.
So no need for me to add on. We'll just QA Ben. Abe, any idea on a timeline of review?
Well, we're reviewing these on a rolling basis, obviously, and we're looking to see if what fits into the ARP plan. So we'll have something by the end of October. That's really when we're going to roll this out. Jamar has his hand up too, if he wants to add anything.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Abe. That part hasn't been exactly clear to me, and maybe I missed when it was mentioned. But is this a rescue plan ask or a general fund ask? I'm not clear on how this is to be paid for.
Well, I'm not going to answer for them, but I think the ask is wherever we could find it. The key is, does it fit into the plan? So I don't think we have to pigeonhole it, but, you know, whatever's available, capital funds, general fund, ARP, we should keep a wide open approach to it. And I would look to where those current expenses currently flow from. Obviously, street sweeping is now currently going from general fund, but equipment is coming from capital, right?
Yeah, it's currently funded out of the general fund. The equipment is not necessarily replaced out of capital.
And some of it may actually come out of sewer. I don't know if it does or doesn't, Jamal.
So perhaps then the administration in their consideration could give some guidance as to where the most appropriate allocation would be, I think.
Certainly, sorry to interrupt. I mean, certainly any questions anyone has, we're more than available to answer those questions, have one-on-one sessions to hopefully work collaboratively to move this forward.
Thanks, Don. I just want to make sure, I thought I saw a hand go up. And any other, okay, so Marcia, and then I'm going to let Dave Tallarico speak.
Yeah, and I just wanted to speak to the decision as far as the funding goes, is we obviously have different sources of funding that each have their own criteria. The administration is in the process of pulling together our budget and capital budget. So we really need to be able to have a decision made by the administration and a recommendation back to council as far as where this fits the best, okay? Because you have to be able to honor the funding restrictions and the implication to the overall budget. It's not to take away from the project, but just to say what's realistic as we move forward in this budget season.
Thanks, Marcia. Dave?
Yeah, I just wanted to appeal to Stan. Like, Stan, we don't claim to know everything you guys do in public works. So like, if we miss something or you think there's something important that we need to deal with or get you some statistics or numbers or anything that you feel that we might have missed, just reach out to us. We'd be glad to talk to you.
Thank you, Dave. I know we talk quite regularly.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for joining us tonight. And we look forward to talking more about this in the near future. All right.
All
right. Council President, I'm going to turn it over to you for the next agenda item.
Oh, you are? Okay.
Unless you want me to continue, I'm not sure.
Yeah, if you don't mind, please. You're fine.
I'll
see my voice.
So I'm looking here, and our next item is public meetings, ways to participate and observe. We have 20 minutes scheduled for that. Before we jump into that, and I'm not sure who will be leading that discussion point, I just want to acknowledge, thank you, Linda. I know that you are navigating through what's happening, the inappropriateness on the chat line. Unfortunately, this is something that is subject to having online and hybrid meetings. So at any time, if you become overwhelmed or if we need to, you know, shut the meeting down and restart, we can do that. So thank you for doing that while we're doing this meeting. And we are acknowledging what's coming through. I know Fred is watching intensely. So from this, was this a council-led item? Was this something on behalf of the clerk's office or the administration to talk about? Marcia?
I had just asked for it to be reinforced, even though we have discussed it in prior meetings. I just wanted to have it down on record. This doesn't need to be complicated, but just to explain what our process is. So it's clearly, again, documented. It's for the public who sometimes people don't understand what's appropriate, what's not. And for our solicitor to reinforce that we are following all the criteria of the Sunshine Act. That's all I wanted to have happen.
So Lucine, if you don't mind, either you or Linda, just walking through what we're currently doing as it relates to allowing public access to our meetings, and then we'll have Fred speak to the points that Marcia just made.
I can kind of review, in terms of public access to meetings, the notice process hasn't changed. So I think really what we need to emphasize and how we emphasize is, when you see an agenda, or if you go to readingpa.gov, it's very clearly outlined because of COVID, the public's prohibited, the different ways in which people can stream the meeting on Facebook Live, the BCTV Mac channels, the city's website. Always going through the city's website, readingpa.gov, but hitting the content/city council videos. If you want to attend, you can do that virtually. You can log in and you can use the link, or you can also dial in by phone for those who have a preference there. There's step-by-step links, whether you want to join, using the URL, whether you want to dial in by phone. Again, the agendas are always prepared and presented in advance of our meetings. I think that something also to review that we've discussed is how people can participate. There has been a question as to how do I register for my comment to be public on record? How do I make comments at the meetings? Or how do I submit something to be written or read, excuse me, onto record, and that's all done online, or by mail to the city clerk's office, or the request can come in to council@readingpa.gov. That has to be done prior to our meetings. But we have had great participation, whether people have come into the meeting to speak, or they've submitted something to be shared or to be read. I think the social media component has really been, a great outreach tool. Although even today we're experiencing how people can misuse or abuse those tools. But it does give us the ability really to present this in streams where before it wasn't possible. And it has increased our viewership. But I want to caution everybody that it's not a participatory option. So if you are streaming this on Facebook, and there might be, comments coming on, through the social media, that is not an actual part of our formal meeting. And that is not a way for you to communicate with us in that we would be, entertaining those questions or comments and or responding to them. That is not an official submission of a question or comment. So I want to make sure that that is very clear to the public. That really that is a viewing tool. That's a tool that we've given you so that anywhere you are in the convenience, of your place and time, you can view the meeting and or see the videos streaming after the fact. Linda, do you want to touch on anything I didn't cover from your perspective?
The one insight I can provide is when people do call the office and ask how they can speak to city council, when we tell them the three ways they can do it, what I usually hear is, wow, that's really convenient.
Okay, well, that's good. We got that on video, right? So that's
yes,
convenient, that's being received positively by our constituency. Well done there.
If you think about it, it is more convenient because they no longer have to get in their car and drive to City Hall. Now they can do it from their kitchen table or in advance in writing.
So other council members, if you'd like to comment at this time or add some insight as to, how the agenda topic is presented and, really talking about ways to participate and observe our meetings. Please Strat feel free.
Here.
Go ahead, Strat.
I'm not disagreeing with what Linda just made a comment on, but I'd like to make a comment also. The people that I've been talking to in my district are more interested in seeing us all together, okay, in council than on television, and trying to get through half the time they can't get through. But I understand I'm watching what he says. In the near future, it's going to be rectified, but I think it's going to get better. It'll be better when we can all sit down and look at each other and let our constituents know what we're doing together. Thank you.
Thank you, Strat. Other comments? Johanny?
Considering providing a space within City Hall for people to come in and watch or the meetings. I think we talked about it, but I'm not sure that we ever came up with a plan regarding the matter.
Yes, that's going on right now. And that was clearly advertised across all the platforms as well.
Right.
The Pen Room?
Yeah, that's where Strat and I are right now. And I also posted the doors.
Got it. So they're welcome to come into that same space that you and Strat are located in. Okay.
Correct. As long as we can control the numbers.
Well, you really can't get that many people in here in this room. Council chambers would be the room to be utilized for having the people coming back into City Hall, not this room. That's my opinion.
Thank you.
Yeah, I see Marcia has her hand up. Johanny, you still have yours. Any other comments, or can Marcia follow up?
Yes, if you don't mind. Yeah, just curious if anyone spoke to any of the protesters that were out at City Hall sometime last week, because I did read in the paper that when they went to protest at RPA, that the executive director actually came out and engaged and spoke with the protesters. I thought that was pretty positive outcome, that he got to listen to them and kind of trying to figure out how to better work with community members.
Well, I was outside there with Joanna. When I was leaving here, I talked to them. That was the night I didn't feel good. And they were upset. They thought that they could get into council chambers, not here, not in this room.
Then they're not reading.
Right. But I'm saying, they were under the impression they were going to get in council, not in this room. And even if you would open the door, how many people are going to put in here? Half a dozen?
No, I'd say three.
Three people?
Yeah.
Isn't that nice? Allowing three people to come into our meeting.
But we could prop the doors open so they could view from the hall.
Well, they don't know that.
So based on Johanny's question, did any other council members or members of administration engage with the protesters last week?
They were nice to me.
Thank you, Strat. Marcia?
Yeah, and just to go back, and it's so good we're having this discussion. I clearly recall that we did have a discussion where we were going to open the pen room because we knew that people who may not be able to access technology would have a place to go in. I also recall very specifically plans were reviewed by the administration to talk about, at this point, City Council chambers does not have the capacity to do the technology necessary. We all reviewed different schemes, what we would look at, what we were going to purchase to upgrade the City Council chambers. And unfortunately, we can't control the pandemic. We can't control what is happening, but we can control public safety and we can provide for public input. So I just want to applaud the administration. I know that it's been patient for our fellow council members. I think we all would prefer to be able to meet in council chambers with the upgraded technology. That's not going to happen at this point. So we just need to do what we can do to make the public feel welcome, to give them all the avenues. I've been letting my constituents know through emails that I send. I send all the links. I communicate with them through text messages, letting them all know these are the ways you can access. If they choose to come in to the pen room, they can do that. But I just want to make sure everyone understands we are doing the best that we can following the advice of our solicitor, which what's allowable under the Sunshine Act.
Thank you, Marcia. Donna, and then Jeff, did you have your...
Yeah, when Donna's done, thank you.
Okay.
I think what is confusing to people is they see different entities having either Zoom meetings or in-person meetings. And I think that creates a confusion right among people, no matter how well we try to get the word out. And I'm not sure how, we mitigate that confusion. I believe now the county commissioners are actually meeting in person and they have taken meetings right on the road to their credit another area. I don't know if that would be a stopgap kind of thing, if at some point we could take a meeting on the road to maybe one of the school sites. I'm not sure what their policy would be. I think this is working as well as it can. It's not the best form of governance when you can't be collectively as a body physically together in a space. No one foresaw this Delta variant occurring. The more people vaccinated, the better. Do we have any concept, any idea of when we will be able to meet collectively as a body in council chambers? Is there any update? Can there be an update in another week or two? I think that's important to let the public know that it is, we are looking at it, we are reconsidering, and we are seeing how both the technology is moving along and the pandemic and the numbers that we're seeing. I believe we're seeing slightly now a decrease, very, very slow decrease in hospitalizations, still significant numbers in terms of people contracting COVID. But I think the more frequently we can let people know that, you know, we're not taking this as this is going to happen 3 months from now, that we're looking at it on a timely basis. That's important for us to communicate.
Okay, thanks, Donna. Go ahead, Jeff.
Well, I know a few people have stated that, you know, they feel that there's been a lack of access, but I don't find that to be true at all. I think our access now is as strong as it's ever been. This body doesn't meet in any kind of constrained manner unless there's legal reasons to do so. That is very far and few between. All of our business is live on TV and Facebook, as well as city streaming. Executive sessions are not, but they are, again, very few issues fall into that category. I've heard zero complaints from anybody in the public, and I walk the streets every day, run into a lot of people, and nobody told me that they feel we are inaccessible during these times. Now, these are different and unique times, but hopefully we're coming to the end of them. But I want to assure the public that this body is very transparent. We don't even have a habit of meeting in groups of three, which would be perfectly legal. We don't even do that. Everything is done in front of the cameras for the most part, so that people can see their business being done appropriately. So there's no gray areas for that. And I don't really like reacting to three or four people who claim otherwise, but you have to be careful.
Jeff, just as an FYI, channel 99, for those who have Comcast, the Mac channel is still off air because of BC.
Temporarily, yeah.
So I think maybe that may be concerning people. They can certainly watch it live streamed on the website, but to be transparent and update people, channel 99 as well as the regular BCTV channel.
That's because
are offline until everything is connected with Comcast and the trunk lines to the new location.
But those meetings are accessible online via Facebook.
Yes. Yeah.
Right. So I just think, you know, I think we're as transparent as we can be. Public participation is just as strong as ever. You can talk via the live meeting, or you can submit a letter, whatever you want to do. And all your council members are accessible directly, as well as your mayor. So I encourage all citizens to share their thoughts, concerns, and ideas, and we're here for the people.
Yeah, thanks, Jeff. And, you know, I agree. I one thing I have heard is that because the meetings are recorded and people can access them on social media platforms, it's actually more convenient to be able to listen to them, you know, a little bit later in the evening, or, you know, the next morning on their walk, or something like that, where typically, you know, people might not have been doing that before. So I think, again, we've experienced, you know, some restrictions, but also on the other side of that, we've advanced in ways we couldn't have imagined, maybe even pushed in that direction before we were even ready. So I want to applaud everybody, you know, really, for doing this for the long haul. You know, we didn't stop, we didn't skip a meeting. You know, we've been here since the beginning, and we've been doing the work of the government for the people. So I just wanna commend, you know, fellow counselors and the staff and everybody who's even worked overtime to be able to make sure that we continue the business that we need to do. And thank you for making sure that this is on the agenda, and always encouraging every single person to reach out in any way that you feel most comfortable to your council representatives or, you know, to the clerk's office. So with that being said, we're going to move on to, was it agenda review, Jeff? Was that?
Yep.
Back and forth. So do you want to?
Yeah, I'll step in for that, Lucine, just so I'm prepared for the meeting. So we're going to go to agenda review. Everyone, thank you for covering those topics. Gives me a chance to rest my voice a little bit. All right. So just pulling up the agenda for our regular council meeting. We have, give me 1 second here. We have Michael Coucher from Transformative Solutions Network scheduled for the invocation. Is that correct, Linda?
He had a conflict, so we will not have an invocation for tonight.
Who?
We won't have an invocation.
Okay, who would like to do the invocation this evening? Anybody, administration, council member, anybody? All right, I'll do it. That's not a problem. We'll move on then to the proclamations. We're going to have a proclamation regarding celebrating Hispanic Heritage Month.
Great.
And Wanda's going to present this. Johanny,
we're commending Wanda.
Johanny, are you going to introduce her?
For her. So I'm trying to get her to Zoom in or link in, but she is teaching classes up until 9 o'clock. So I'm still trying to work out the details as far as her receiving it.
Okay. All right. We can at least present it, anyway. At least read it, yeah. And get it to her later on. All right, Linda, public comment. We have two written comments. Anything beyond that?
Yeah.
All right. Who is willing to read the written comments onto the record? Donna, all right, make sure Donna has those. All right, and then we're gonna go into our approval of agenda and minutes. Most importantly, our consent agenda items. The first item is amending the CDBG action plan in the amount of $1.3 million in CDBG funding to replace Engine 3, which is currently housed at 3rd and Court Streets, and also to replace Engine 9 housed at 9th and Marion. The CDBG funding will be provided by closing out the previous year CDBG activities and reducing the funding for the delayed Department of Public Works projects and assist meeting the annual CDBG timelines test requirement. A couple things here, guys. So this resolution is approving just the spending on the engines. Are we going to get a separate ordinance moving around the CDBG dollars?
If that is necessary, Council President, I'm certain we can accommodate that request, yes.
Yeah, I think that's typically how we move them around, Abe, just so you know.
Sure, we can do that.
Stan, go ahead, you had a comment?
Yes, I believe, Abe, you're right. We were talking about this the other day, and yes, that is correct. We will draft.
Okay, so just so the members understand, they're telling us in this resolution where the money's coming from, and then they're going to provide us with an ordinance to make those changes. But this ordinance is approving those two apparatuses, correct?
That's on tonight's agenda for introduction.
Oh, it's already on there?
Yes.
Okay, good. All right, and then any comments or questions on these engines, council members?
Just for clarity, this the engines, the bid, they didn't go out for bid yet. This is just the approval of the, this is just for the change.
Okay, this is just to get the bids going. Is that what you're saying?
Well, just the approval of the change in the action plan.
Gotcha. Okay.
So this I don't want to speak for community development.
Well, in this
situation, but there's.
Let's understand this. Let me look under ordinances because I want to make sure we have this down.
Yeah, there's nothing. No, the specs just getting finalized with the purchasing department for that.
Yeah, I don't see. So the ordinance isn't on introductions, Linda. What are you saying? Which ordinance is where?
I think I was referring to F, but that's for the.
That's for the building.
F is for tied to the station.
Yeah. Yes,
something different. Well, yeah.
Yes.
This resolution really won't move the CDBG dollars. That, Linda, am I right? That has to be done by ordinance.
Right.
Yeah, the action plan is approved by ordinance, so it has to be amended by ordinance.
Yeah, so we.
No, can, it's not. The action plan is a resolution.
All right. So the moving of the funds then need to be by ordinance.
We've never done that.
Do we do the entire CDBG plan by resolution? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, we have. Always. All right.
Well, then I'm wrong. Okay. So this is okay the way it stands.
Correct.
I'm just used to moving monies via ordinances, guys. So this is fine.
There's Jamal weighing in there. Oh,
yeah.
Okay, great. All right. Any comments on this resolution? So this is just moving the money. And then once the chief finalizes a final contract, they'll come to our approval for the purchase. Correct, chief?
Yeah, I'm working with the spec will be in with purchasing. They'll get it out for bid. And then we'll bring the purchase forward to contract for that.
Sorry, that was my confusion. Any comments, anyone from council? All right, we'll move on to the next item under the consent agenda. A resolution authorizing the execution and resubmission of the application for phase two of the Eggleman's Park Improvement Project. Total project cost of $325,000, $250,000 of which will come through a DCED Greenways Trails and Recreation Program grant. And the other $75,000 is going to come through the capital budget. Stan, somebody want to give us just a real brief recap of this?
Yes, this is for phase two of Engelmann's. And this is working closely with Jamar and his team to understand the commitment of the dollars and in terms of the design of the project itself. So it's been working out well.
Also, the application that initially went in had the wrong date on it, so we had to update the cost estimate. And with the updated cost estimate, we needed to send a new resolution from City Council reauthorizing the application.
Okay, sorry about that. The next item, any comments? Yeah. Go ahead, yeah. Mark.
Just because District 2, the folks that live up in that area are always having questions about it, I would ask that this be pulled and put on as a resolution so I can just ask the administration to update what this project entails. It's been a long time and some of the public have lost contact. I would rather it be recorded that I can then reference folks to where it's discussed in the meeting.
All right, so you want to move this under resolutions is what you're saying?
Yeah, exactly.
All right, we'll do that. Any comments or questions from anybody regarding the resolution itself at this point while we're reviewing it? All right, if not, we'll move on to the next item. Oh, Johanny, I saw your hand. There you go.
For the prior one, but you didn't see it. In the attachments regarding the first resolution regarding the CDBG funds, when you look at the attachments, I'm gonna revise the attachments to see if it makes sense with what it is that we're approving, we're trying to vote on today. One that relates to approving the amendment, and then there's a second one that has a resolution on it. For next year, for 20, I think, I'm thinking we're in 2020. Never mind. I think for the next year, I'm sorry.
All right, additional comments? I'm sorry, I had to step away there for a second. Did you get your question answered, Johanny?
I just read it again. I'm so sorry. I just wanted to make sure that whatever we were voting on coincided with the attachments. That's all.
Gotcha. All right. If there's no additional questions on that, item will go to number three here under the consent agenda, which is an award of contract. Actually, I'm just going to ask somebody to step through the next five award of contracts for us. We see the plumbing, electrical, general contracting, and fire protection. Can somebody walk through the costs and
just... Yeah, I'll step through, and if Stan wants to jump in or Jamar, they can. If you recall, back in July, the project went out to bid for the five prime contracts, that being the general contractor, the electrical, the plumbing, the fire protection, and the mechanical HVAC. September 9th, all the proposals were, the bids were received at that point for four of the five. We didn't get one for HVAC. Nobody bid on the project. The purchase, that doesn't keep us from going forward. The HVAC is currently back out to be rebid. The four contracts that are on the agenda here are where the low bids received for those respective services, and that's what we're bringing forward here.
All right. Cost for each of those. Can you tie them in real quick, Chief?
Can I tie them in as far as, let me step through each one. The $5,000,948 is for the general contracting services for the project. That's that one. The plumbing with Vision Mechanical would be for $646,940. The electrical portion of that would be $1,048,000. and the triangle for the fire protection system, that would be the sprinkler contractor, and all would be $127,900 for that. Again, triangle, I believe, was the only bidder for that portion. I believe there were two bids. We see the electric, let me just take a quick look here. I think on the electrical, they received, it was three for electrical. Again, Hernizen was the low bid. Two for plumbing, it was Vision, and another one, Vision was low. And then there were six general contractors that bid on the project, with Parado being the lowest of the four. All these contracts were reviewed by our Oil Construction, who's our project manager on this, and our the city solicitor. And following their review, it was recommended that we can move forward with these contracts, with the approval of these. And that they met the requirements.
All right, so we're looking somewhere between $7.6 and $8 million, and Parado is the winning bidder on the construction, is what you're saying.
On the general construction, yes.
Okay, just want to make sure everyone understood the breakdown of those contracts. Does anybody have any comments or questions?
Chief, did you add that there's going to be one more coming, the mechanical
comes up? Yeah, I'm sorry. I did mention that we're out for rebid on the HVAC for mechanical. That's anticipated. That's going to be roughly around $1 million for that one.
All right. Okay. If there are no other questions, we will step through those. Chief, I don't know if you could email me those breakout. Well, I have them. That's fine. I can pull up the full document. No problem. All right. I just want to refer to them as I read those items on the agenda. Typically, they're there, but I'll read through them. That's fine. All right, the next item on the agenda will be administrative report. We have Abe here this evening, and the mayor.
Actually, Council President, the mayor is going to be reading the report this evening.
Okay, good. And then we have Maria for the auditor's report. We do not have any reports this evening from boards, authorities, and commissions. We will move right on to ordinances for final passage. The first one, pardon my voice here, is Bill 65-2021, authorizing the transfer of $45,000 within the 2021 Department of Public Works Utilities Division budget from contracted services to Power and Light to cover storm-related electrical costs for the rest of the year. So it's introduced at the September 13th regular meeting. Again, this looks like we're just switching some funds around from one light item to the other within Public Works. Any comments or questions on this? If not, the next ordinance is 67-2021. Again, authorizing a budget transfer for legal services rendered to the Charter Board in the amount of $30,000 from the Law Special Counsel Legal Services. Fred, what is that year to date for the Charter Board? Do you know?
I do not know. We actually have, as you might recall, a firm reviewing their bills due to conflicts.
Mm-hmm. Any comments, members of council? If not, we'll move on to the next ordinance, Bill 68-2021, authorizing the amendment of the CIP budget by providing $248,578 in funding for the cost of the fire system upgrades at the main library building. This is to be paid by Public Works public property budget line item. Any comments or questions on this? It's pretty self-explanatory. As everyone knows, we're responsible for the upkeep of the building, and it's a very nice sound building, so we want it to be well protected. All right, and the next item is Bill number 69-2021, authorizing the transfer of $1,033,992.26 within the agency fund from contracted services to grants and gifts for the purchase of EMS equipment using $983,672.73 in FEMA grant funding. First of all, is that saying the 983 is part of the 1,033,000?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. So we're capitalizing the use of a grant here. And does anybody, how many, are we buying ambulances with this?
No, we're buying a defibrillator, heart monitors, AEDs for the apparatus. This, as we discussed last month, is part of a regional FEMA grant where there's seven other agencies and we're the host on this. Gotcha. The 900 some thousand is what's coming in from FEMA. The other 50, I believe some it is, will be coming to us that we build out to the other agencies that'll be coming into this line and all to pay for the total of this.
It's good stuff. It saves lives, right?
Yes. Thank you.
All right. Any comments or questions, members of the body on that? No. All right. The next item is 70-2021, authorizing the appropriation of $3 million in American Rescue Plan Act funding to the Berks County Convention Center Authority for the Santana Arena and the Performing Arts Center to assist with them to recover from the financial losses due to the closure of the facilities during the pandemic. Pretty self-explanatory. Any comments or questions from members of the body? All right. Next item is number 71-2021, authorizing the amendment of the Capital Improvement Plan budget to transfer funds in the amount of $46,425 to cover the cost of the Third and Spruce Gym HVAC system. Is that a whole new system, Stan?
No, that is just the pair of rooftop systems specifically for the gym. We are in design of the entire building's HVAC system as we speak.
Great, okay.
We had an emergency, so we had to fix it.
Any other comments or questions from the body? All right. And then the final ordinance for passage this evening is increasing the base salary of the deputy police chief to $101,757.04. I think we've gone through that pretty thoroughly. Does anybody have any additional questions on that matter?
Yeah, it's Marcia.
Yep.
Just to clarify, this is for the position, not for the person. I think we wanted to have that cleared up in the verbiage.
Let me take a look at it, Marcia.
We amended to take the name out, so it is just referring to the position.
Okay. All right, thank you. All right, that takes care of ordinances for final.
Yes, Donna has her hand up.
Go ahead, Donna, sorry.
Is this something that's going to be incorporated then with all the negotiations so that the chief and the deputy chief are now part of the whole unit going forward, as opposed to constantly every year or whatever having to deal with this for those positions? And the salaries that are now, if there are changes, are those salaries standard or will there be adjustments along the way?
I'm not sure exactly what you're asking, but just the way it worked with Chief Tornelli's, the ordinance we passed in April, this will tie their salary and their benefits to any awards in the future as well, so that it wouldn't
need. This won't necessarily be a yearly thing. It may be every few years,
however often the CBAs are renegotiated.
And are the base salaries for these positions going to stay standard then going forward? I guess maybe that's beyond the scope of this.
It would depend on what happens with the CBAs if they address base salaries.
So these are for these positions now, but the positions and salaries and considerations could change along the way.
That is correct. For the positions. Yes, that would all be part of the collective bargaining agreement negotiations. Yes.
Well, I'm saying should the personnel in those positions change? Are these standard salaries then that will always go forward?
I mean, that was the change that was requested last time. And that was, I think, kind of the reason why the ordinances had been kind of personal, was so that you might have a situation in the future where it's not a homegrown, so to speak. deputy chief or a homegrown chief, and you might not want to do this, but we could always change the ordinance. You always, if a
so
new,
how does that separate so the positions refer to the people in them, no matter how this is looked at in whatever, the people in them, it's there's still a personal aspect to it. Let's
put
it
right. And it'll work for okay, the I just want to while clarify they're in that. Place, while the current personnel is in place.
Okay, so it is subject to change if there is a change in a person in those positions.
Correct, but it would have to be done by ordinance. You could reset the salaries.
Okay, so all I'm saying is I understand how it's written, but the reality is it's based on the individuals there because they're there at this point. Correct?
I'm not sure I understand what you mean by that.
If Joe Schmo or Jane Doe comes in, the position is still there, but things change.
Right, you could change.
So it is specific, even though we're saying it's not.
Well, all positions, yeah, have some performance attributes to it. And when you hire somebody new, it doesn't take away, the new candidate isn't locked into the salary. They may want more, we may offer them less. What Fred's saying is at that time, we would amend the position ordinance and the salary to reflect.
But I mean, I'm just trying to make it clear that, you know, we're phrasing it in a very diplomatic way, but the reality is specific to what situation is at this point in time.
That's correct, Counselor. For example, when I was brought on, there was a range provided. I wasn't given the top end of that range. It was decided to be in the middle. And then the ordinance reflected that at the meeting after my hiring. So if we brought on a new chief or a new deputy chief at that time, the administration and council would have the prerogative to either reset it or keep it in place as it was at that time.
So this particular ordinance refers to just one individual at this point in time?
The position of the deputy chief, yes.
Any additional questions on this matter? All right, if not, we'll move on to the introduction.
Yeah, Johanna has her hand up.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, Johanna, I cannot see these hands. So when I ask if somebody,
I'm sorry.
I just need you to verbalize it. I'm sorry.
Okay.
In the chambers, you see it.
Sometimes I see it, sometimes I don't. I got so many screens, I got the agenda, I got. Oh, go ahead, Johanna.
No worries. No, I mean, I do understand though that there's a more collective bargaining agreement discussions taking place, right? Because all of this is going to expire at the end of this year, right? So as we're working on budgets for the new year, things may be subject to change based on those agreements.
I'm sorry, counselor, just to correct, the current contract expires at the end of 2022. So it would not change for 2022. It would change in 2023, if anything.
Okay, thank you, Jamar. I thought I saw it concluded in 2021 somewhere, but okay, thank you.
Okay, are there any additional comments, anyone? All right, we're gonna move on to the introduction of new ordinances. The first one is authorizing an increase in the base salary of the wastewater treatment plant laboratory supervisor by $5,000 a year, payable in equal bi-monthly installments, retroactive to the beginning of this year due to an increase in responsibilities. Pretty self-explanatory. Does anybody have any comments or questions relevant to that? All right, the next item being introduced is amending the City Code Chapter 576, Vehicles and Traffic, Part 13, Motorized Devices, Section 1306D, by adding the requirement for the ATV / dirt bike owner to provide proof of title and proof of insurance prior to the release of the vehicle. I'm assuming we're just cleaning this ordinance up, Linda?
That's correct.
All right, anybody have any comments, Marcia?
I just think it's so important. We have as many strong tools as we can in our arsenal to deal with this problem. So I really applaud the police department when they confiscate the vehicles that are driven dangerously. And I think this just strengthens what they're able to do then.
All right, any additional comments? All right, thank you, Marcia. We're gonna move on to the next item. Number 3C here, amending the Code of Ordinances, Chapter 62, New Officers and Employees Pension Fund, Section 102, to prohibit the participation of new members where the employee is hired or rehired on or after November 1st, 2021. Who can walk us through this explanation?
Yes, Council President. We'd actually like to amend this to reflect January 1 of 2022. And this ordinance is tied to the new defined contribution plan that we've been explaining to council in the recent months. This defined contribution plan will transition non-uniform employees away from the current pension plan that the city offers and to a 401k style plan instead of a traditional pension. So this ordinance in particular would freeze the current plan as it is and not allow new members to be added.
So Marcia, would you mind when you're reading this to denote January 1st, 2022? Anybody have any questions or comments on this ordinance?
Yeah, thank you.
All right, we'll move on then to ordinance D, amending the city code chapter 23, part 7. By repealing the Minority Business Procurement Advisory Board and replacing it with the Equal Business Opportunity Advisory Board. I think we did recently discuss this. Does anybody have any comments or questions on this ordinance? All right. The next ordinance is E, amending the position ordinance by increasing the base salary of the auditing coordinator by $3,600, which is available from salary savings in the salary line item of the city order 2021 budget, bringing the salary to $55,000. Any comments on this specific ordinance? Maria, did you have a quick comment?
Yes, the reason that I'm asking for the increase is because I want to bring this, I would like council to approve the increase for this position. So that way this position can be aligned with other position in the county department in regarding to responsibility and regarding responsibility and also degree and stuff like that, certifications.
All right, any comments or questions, council members? All right, we're gonna move on then to ordinance F, amending the Fund 43 City Facility Construction Fund Budget Ordinance, reallocated $1 million in funding for the construction of the new 9th and Marion Fire Station. Obviously, that's only a portion of the funding. Damar, did you want to give us a kind of an overview on how that's going to tranche out moving forward?
Yes, thank you, Council President. This ordinance allows us to move $1 million of the construction fund that council set aside many years ago for this project. It'll move it from fund balance into an account that we can use for part of the construction cost through the end of this fiscal year.
Yeah, and Jamar, remind us again how much we put into that that general fund, kind of enterprise fund at the time.
$4 million for the fire stations and $400,000 for the sidewalk repair.
Gotcha. All right, council. So this is just the formal way of releasing it out of that fund and putting it in an account so the chief and the construction team can access it to pay off contractors. Any comments or questions on that? All right. And then the...
I think Johanny has her hand up.
Go ahead, Johanny. You got to speak up. I can't see you.
Yeah, sorry. And it's not, I'm sorry that I'm a little delayed. It was a question after I heard Maria's request. I'm just curious if we are exploring all salaries and positions and making sure that every salary matches the position, qualifications, experience, et cetera. Because I never see the Human Resource Department involved in any of these requests. So I'm just curious if the department then should be.
Yeah, I'm going to defer that to our budget discussions. I think we'll have an opportunity
I just want to say that by looking all the position, the county department in regard to responsibility and requirement, and that is the reason why I want to bring it up, because for the auditing coordinator, we're asking for experience in auditing, and also they had to have a degree the 4 year, at least 4 year degrees.
All right, so yeah, so we can address that, you know, in the broad-based budget discussion, Johanny, and, you know, as we justify the position ordinances and the salaries, you know, it's a good time to say, what are we doing to bring all these up to speed and what's that process look like? Any other comments? All right, if there are no other comments, I think that's the end of our introductions.
I do have a question.
There is one ordinance, sorry.
Go ahead, Marcia, then we'll go to Jamar.
Just a clarification of where the 2022 needs to come in, because I thought I wrote it down and now I realize I didn't write it down in the correct place.
Ordinance C?
That's what I thought. So it's November 1st, 2022?
No, January 1st, 2022.
January 1st, okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Jamar, did I miss something? I did.
Yes, Ordinance G, Council President.
Yep, okay. Ordinance G, amending the City Code Chapter 62, New Officers and Employees Pension Fund, by adding a defined contribution plan. So this is kind of going hand in hand with Ordinance C. We're going to be adding a defined contribution plan. That's going to start January 1st. And this ordinance is incorporating that plan into the city process. Is that correct, Jamar?
200% correct. It'll allow us to insert the plan document into the legislation section on the website for easy access to any member of the employee staff.
Okay. Any comments on that specific ordinance? All right. If there are no comments, we don't have any resolutions. It looks like before we adjourn, does anybody have anything critical for public discussion before we adjourn for our regular meeting? All right. So it's about five of. Let's plan on starting at 7:05. So everyone should try to log in at about 5 minutes so we can get going right around 7:05. Thank you.